Hey guys, welcome to all of you on our channel, that is Achieve IAS. So how are you? I hope you are doing well. So friends, in today's video we are announcing a brand new series in which we will daily discuss your current affairs but with the approach of MCQ. So what this approach is, in this what we will do, we will daily discuss 10 MCQs, and those MCQs will be based upon the current affairs of that particular day or the previous day. So for example, if today is 19th August, so we will be discussing today the MCQs of 18th August. So why we are keeping a lag of one day, so that we can prepare quality MCQs, so that the quality of your MCQs is not compromised, and so that your current affairs are comprehensively covered. Because when current affairs relating to a particular day come, they have to be collected from multiple sources. So this this initiative will help you in covering your current affairs with an approach of MCQ based discussion. So let's start our discussion. So the first question is, consider the following movements, protests and their respective location. First, Red Movement, Sudan. Second, Umbrella Movement, France. Third, Yellowist Movement, Hong Kong. Fourth, Arab Spring Movement, Tunisia. Fifth, Mother of All Marches, Venezuela. So we have to choose that which of the above pair is correctly matched. So let me tell you friends that second and third are incorrect, because Umbrella recently the protests are taking place in Hong Kong and they are broadly referred to as Umbrella Movement, and Yellowist Movement took place recently in France. So only second and third are wrong. So correct would be 1, 4 and 5, that is Red Movement is related to Sudan and Arab Spring Movement Tunisia. Fifth is Mother of All Marches, Venezuela. So these pairs are correctly matched. So your solution is B. So recent Hong Kong protests, as I've told you, they are often called the protests are often called Umbrella Movement, that are taking place in Hong Kong, and in France Yellowist protests took place. So now next question is, consider the following statements related to National Knowledge Network. First, the network aims to provide broadband connectivity to all the 2.5 lakh gram panchayats. Second, the project is a component of Umbrella Digital India program. So we have to tell that which of the above statement is correct. So let me tell you friends that the first statement is wrong, because National Knowledge Network is not doesn't aim to connect 2.5 lakh gram panchayats. Rather, it aims to connect the research institutes, educational institutes, so that a national knowledge network can emerge and knowledge can freely flow between various government research institutions. So yes, it is a part of Digital India program. So second is correct, but first statement is wrong. So the answer would be B. Solution is B. So here you can see about this National Knowledge Network. So development of India's communication infrastructure. So what it does, basically it aims to collaborate, bring collaboration among different researchers from different educational networks. So purpose is to basically connect all universities, research institutions, libraries, laboratories, healthcare and agricultural institutions across the country to address such paradigm shift. Basically the purpose is to enable collaborative research, development and innovation, because now the research institutes will be able to share all the information, and it will provide a high speed backbone connectivity which will enable knowledge and information sharing among the knowledge network, National Knowledge Network connected institutes. So here you can see it also aims to promote the advanced distance learning in specialized fields, for example engineering, science and medicine, and also aims to provide backbone to e-governance, and also facilitating connection between different sectoral networks in the field of research. So this is basically your diagram. So as you might have seen, that this is not related to the connecting of gram panchayats, but rather it aims to connect the educational institutions, research labs and all other important national institutes. Your third question is, consider the following statements related to gamma rays. First, gamma rays are the weakest rays in the electromagnetic spectrum. Second, during nuclear explosion gamma rays get emitted. So we have to choose that which of the above statement is correct. So let me tell you friends that the first statement is incorrect. They are not the weakest, but rather they are highly energetic. Second is yes, second is correct. Mostly they are emitted by very hot substances like neutron stars, pulsars, and all the, around these black holes. So yes, when nuclear explosion takes place, gamma rays are emitted. So the only option that will be correct is B, that is second only. So the solution is B. So basically they are highly energetic and produced by the hottest and most energetic objects in the universe. For example, neutron stars, pulsars, supernova explosions, and regions around black holes. So on Earth, gamma waves are generated by nuclear explosions, lightning, and less dramatic activity of radioactive decay. So it is not just the hottest substances, but also nuclear explosions as well as lightning events and less dramatic activity of, for example, a radioactive element is decaying, then it will also emit gamma rays. So scientists also use these gamma rays to get an idea about the elements that are present on other planets. Because scientists will get an idea about the gamma rays emitted by different elements, and in this way they can determine that which element is present on which planet. So your fourth question is, let's move on to the fourth question. Fourth question is, consider the following statements related to Jammu and Kashmir issue. First, both Shimla Agreement 1972 and Lahore Declaration 1999 aims to resolve the Jammu and Kashmir issue bilaterally. Second, United Nations Security Council Resolutions 38, 39, 47 are related to Jammu and Kashmir issue. So we have to choose that which of the above is correct. So let me tell you friends that both of these are correct, because yes, Shimla Agreement also and also your Lahore Declaration. Shimla Agreement was basically signed between the Prime Minister of India, former Prime Minister of India, that is Indira Gandhi, and former Prime Minister of Pakistan, Zulfikar Ali Bhutto. And Lahore Declaration was signed between former Prime Minister of India, that is Atal Bihari Vajpayee, and former Prime Minister of Pakistan, that is Nawaz Sharif. So yes, UNSC Resolution 38, 39, 47 are related to Jammu and Kashmir issue. So both are correct. So the solution will be C. So both these, basically Shimla Agreement was much more than just a peace treaty. So it was also about a kind of withdrawing the troops and also exchanging the prisoners of wars. War that took place between India and Pakistan in 1971, which resulted in the formation of Bangladesh. So the purpose was to bring a blueprint for good neighborly relations between India and Pakistan. So the purpose was to basically the agreement that was reached was basically to abjure conflict and confrontation and to work towards development of durable peace, friendship, and cooperation. So also there was a focus on promotion of a friendly and harmonious relationship and establishment of durable peace in subcontinent, which in any case has not been established until now. So also Lahore Declaration is also there, that was signed between Vajpayee government and former Prime Minister of Pakistan Nawaz Sharif government. So also your resolutions 38 resolution is basically calling upon both the countries to take immediately all those measures calculated to improve the situation and to refrain from making any statements or from doing or causing to be done or permitting any acts which might aggravate the situation. So basically both this 38 resolution aims to bring peace between India and Pakistan by not doing any such activity which could be prejudicial to peace. So it asks both the governments to inform the council immediately of any material change if it is taking place, if they observe that it is taking place by either of them, and or is about to occur while the matter is under consideration of council, and consult with the council thereon. And then there is resolution 39 of UNSC, which also says that it set up a 3-member commission. So please remember it, resolution 39 of United Nations Security Council set up a 3-member UN Commission for India and Pakistan, composed of representatives of 3 members of United Nations, one to be selected by India and one to be selected by Pakistan, and third to be designated by the 2 so selected. So by the resolution 39, the United Nations Commission for India and Pakistan was appointed with 3 members, and it has been invested with multiple functions, that is to investigate facts pursuant to Article 34 of the Charter of United States, and to exercise without interrupting the work of Security Council any mediatory influence that could smooth away difficulties, and it also has a responsibility to carry the directions given to it by the Supreme Court and to report how far the advice and directions, if any, of the Security Council have been carried out. So, but this also has not prevented the disagreements to emerge between India and Pakistan, and then there is Resolution 47. So, Resolution 47, dated 21st April 1949, 48, it highlighted to need to restore peace and order. So, also it held that accession of Jammu and Kashmir between India or Pakistan should be decided by the democratic and democratic method of a free and fair and impartial plebiscite. So, the issue of plebiscite that is time and again being raised by the Pakistan or by some elements in Kashmir also, they refer to the resolution of 47 of the United Nations Security Council. So it called upon the and also it reaffirmed the resolution 38, and also it increased the membership of the United Nations Commission on India and Pakistan to 5. Earlier the membership was 3, but then the membership was increased to 5. And also it instructed the commission to place its good offices and mediation in Indian subcontinent at disposal of both governments to take necessary measures to restore peace and order and hold a plebiscite. So conditions were so plebiscite has been called upon. So also United Nations Commission for India and Pakistan also passed a resolution on January 5, 1945-49 that called for a free and impartial plebiscite. But the issue that has been there that India why India is not providing for plebiscite and cannot provide for plebiscite is that the condition that the Pakistan must also withdraw from the territory that is POK which it has occupied after the raid of October of 1947. So unless and until Pakistan is not doing that, how can we do that? So obviously we will not be doing that. This is our official position and this should remain our official position without any doubt. So key conditions for plebiscite is withdrawal of Pakistan, and if it is not taking place, then why should we withdraw our troops and why we should conduct plebiscite in that scenario? Unless and until Pakistan is not withdrawing troops from POK, so there is no such obligation on us that conditions are imposed on us. Then fifth question is the drugs pretomanid, bedaquiline, linezolid can be associated with which of the following diseases? A. Anthrax, B. Tuberculosis, C. Zika virus, D. Ebola disease. So, friends, this question is because recently the United States this Food and Drug Organization has approved a drug that is pretomanid. So, this is basically these are basically drugs related to TB. So, this Food and Drug Administration has approved this new drug, and it is only the third new anti-TB drug approved by FDA in more than 40 years. So it was developed by a non-profit organization based in New York, that is TB Alliance. So duration of treatment basically drug resistant. There is a MDR TB. You might be aware of that TB, that is multi-drug resistance TB. So duration for treatment of it takes quite lengthy time, that is 18 to 24 months. But this pretomanid is expected to reduce that duration to 6 to 9 months if it is given in addition to two already approved drugs, that is bedaquiline and linezolid. So all oral three drug regimen can improve the treatment and success rate, and also can reduce potentially the number of deaths due to better adherence to treatment. So what is MDR-TB or XDR-TB? This basically XDR-TB or MDR-TB is that TB, as is clear from name, it is drug resistant. So already those drugs which are in place for the treatment of TB, if in case they are ineffective on a particular person in the treatment of the TB, then he per se that person could be termed to be suffering from MDR-TB. So the definition for it is that the person who doesn't respond to at least isoniazid and rifampicin, that person is termed as suffering from MDR-TB. And those persons who are suffering from XDR-TB, they are resistant. They show resistance to isoniazid and rifampin plus any quinolone and at least one of the three injectable second line drugs, that is amikacin, kanamycin or capreomycin. So this statistics is important. So World Health Organization report, TB report that was published in 2018, it said that 4.5 lakh people are there in the world over who are suffering from this MDR or MDR-TB, and there are 37,500 people suffering from XDR-TB. So India accounts for nearly 24% of these MDR-TB which experience drug resistance. So this drug will help those people. And your sixth question is, consider the following statements with respect to disqualification of elected members. First, a person disqualified to contest election on corruption charge may not be allowed to contest for the polls for the following 6 years. Second, election commission has the power to reduce the term of disqualification under the People of Representation of Act 1951. So we have to choose that which of the above is correct. So both of these are correct. If a person is convicted under the Prevention of Corruption Act, then he or she is disqualified for contesting elections for 6 years, and this sentence could be reduced on the powers of election commission that are given to it under the Representation of People Act 1951. So both 1 and 2 are correct. So the answer is C. So basically, if there are various grounds under which a person who is convicted under various offenses can be disqualified for contesting elections. So these offenses are if the person is convicted for promoting enmity among various groups, section 153A and section 505, and if the offense is related to rape and cruelty towards women, and then also, and then there is also, if there is Dohri Prohibition Act, there is a conviction under Dohri Prohibition Act, and also offense of bribery, undue influence or personation at an election, section under section 171E and section 171F. So also offenses committed under acts like Protection of Civil Liberties Act, Customs Act, Narcotics, Drugs and Psychotropic Substances Act, Foreign Exchange Management, and etc. So this is the sixth question. Let's move on to the next question. Seventh question is, India and Bhutan signed memorandum of understanding agreement on which of the following? First, hydropower purchase agreement. Second, investigation of air accident. Third, technical education. Fourth, motorway agreement. So which of the above is correct? So we have to choose that which of the above statements is correct. So India and Bhutan, friends, recently signed a agreement. So you must be knowing about that recently Prime Minister Narendra Modi was there in Bhutan. So all these three agreements have been signed. So answer is, solution is B. So these are the details. So you can read these details by pausing the video. So the multiple memorandum of understandings were signed. So it is difficult to read each and every one here. And let's move on to the eighth question. Eighth question is, which of the following statements related to algae based biofuel are right? First, algae based biofuel belongs to second generation based biofuels. Second, it is highly clean fuel and emissions are very minimal. And third is, it leads to deforestation. Fourth is, it absorbs the CO2 emissions from the atmosphere. So we have to choose the correct answer. So let me tell you, friend, that algae based biofuel is not second generation based biofuel, but it is third generation biofuel. And your second statement is correct. Yes, it is highly clean and emissions are very minimal. But third question is not correct. It doesn't lead to deforestation. And fourth statement is correct. Yes, it absorbs CO2, because these algae, they basically absorb CO2 and they emit oxygen. So thus they absorb CO2 concentration in atmosphere. So second and four are correct. So the answer would be B. So there are many algae that are found in ponds, lakes and rivers, and they are packed lipids which are basically fatty and acid molecules, and they have the oil, and that can be extracted to power diesel engines. So they are very helpful. So multiple benefits are there. So they have to power simultaneously fuel vehicles, recycle carbon dioxide and provide nutrition to animals and humans. But the challenge is that how to upscale the growing of such algae. So because researchers are trying to figure out how to grow enough number of the right strains of algae, and also how to attract the oil most efficiently. So advantages are that it doesn't compete with food crops for land availability. For example, there are various food crops that are first generation biofuels, so but they occupy land. So obviously that land is not required for it. So like jatropha and ethanol, which require land, this algae biodiesel doesn't require land. And then there is they are highly clean and they can be grown on brackish or polluted water also, so they don't require fresh water. And then there is also they consume carbon dioxide and emit oxygen, so obviously carbon dioxide concentration is reduced in the atmosphere. And also jatropha, which can be harvested after only 6 months, so these algae can be harvested on daily basis. So let's move on to the next question. Next question is, consider the following statements related to National Green Tribunals. So first statement is, it is headquartered in New Delhi. Second, it is established under the Article 21 of the Indian Constitution. Third, it works under the principle of natural justice. Fourth, its verdict is final and not subject to further appeal. So here we have to choose that which of the above statements is correct. So friends, let me tell you, yes, first statement is correct. Its principal headquarters are in New Delhi. And yes, it has been established under Article 21 of the Indian Constitution. And yes, it follows the principle of natural justice. But fourth statement is not correct. Its verdicts can be appealed in Supreme Court. So the answer would be C. So these are some details. So you can see the, so it is a statutory body established under National Green Tribunal Act 2010. So basically it deals with those issues. It has the power of we can say a court equivalent to court, and has all the power over all civil cases involving substantial question relating to environment. So any complaint, any legal enforcement of the right to environment, so all such cases have to be disposed by this National Green Tribunal within 6 months of the filing of the same. So it has five places of sitting, and New Delhi is the principal place sitting, and also then there is Bhopal, Pune, Kolkata and Chennai. So though it is not bound by Code of Civil Procedure 1908, but it follows the principle of natural justice, and also while passing any order, decision, award, it shall apply the principles of sustainable development, precautionary principle and the polluter pay principle. So this is your ninth question, and let's move on to the last question of the day. Which of the above following statements is correct? First is depowered Beal wetland ecosystem is present in Assam. Second, it is declared as Ramsar site. So we have to choose that which of the statements is correct. So let me tell you friends that both these statements are correct. So the solution is C. So a wetland is a place where the land is covered by water, marshes, ponds and the edge of a lake, the delta, these are the details of different Ramsar sites. So this is all about friends today's video. If you like these MCQs, if you like the video, then do ensure that you like it, share it with your friends, and also ensure that you subscribe to our channel. And lastly friends, if in case you are interested to join, if you are interested to get the PDFs of these daily MCQs, then you can mail us at achieveias21@gmail.com, or you can contact us at 8968920720. So at a cost of 99, that is 99 rupees, you will be subscribed to 1 month daily MCQs. So in 99 rupees, you will be getting nearly 300 MCQs. So it is a very small amount for you people. So obviously it will help us also to remain motivated. So if in case you are interested to get the PDF, then you can mail us or you can contact us. So this is all about friends today's video. Do ensure that you like it. And also the link of the payment will also be provided in the description box. So once you make the payment, we will automatically get the notification that you have subscribed. So we will mail you and we will send you all the PDFs that are relating to this current affairs. So this is all about today's video. Thank you. Have a very nice day ahead.